gaming. Gaming never changes. Atari turned playtime into dots on a screen, replacing toys and board games in countless households. Sony flooded the market with middle shelf titles that would make people talk about flawed gems for decades to come. The seventh generation turned a niche hobby into an economic superpower with microtransactions. But gaming never changed. Alright, enough of this. I'm not a Ron Perlman. The original Fallout games are near and dear to my heart. I got Fallout 2 on a disc attached to a magazine when I was a wee lad. My parents thought a game with a funny cartoon person on the disc is going to be okay for an 8-year-old to play, but it was not. This explains a lot about my development as a human being, honestly. The game was mercilessly difficult, especially for a child that didn't speak English and always forgot about saving the game regularly. But over a decade of growing up, I returned to it again and again, swearing I will beat it one day. The game is a huge reason why I treated learning English so seriously, which again explains a lot about the way I ended up. So yeah, if you have a complaint about my videos, please send it to whatever office building Black Isle used to occupy. So of course, I also played Fallout 1, and I was disappointed by it. It seemed extremely bare bones compared to 2, much shorter with less quests, lackluster companions and bare bones dialogue options. The world and audiovisual design were very cool, but I already saw all of that. I didn't think much of it. I decided that I just like 2 more than 1 and moved on with my life. All of this because I treated Fallout 1 based on what it does as a role-playing game and not what it was trying to say as a narrative medium. Growing up and having all these puzzles click into place made me appreciate it so much more. The original Fallout is very specifically a game about the ruins of America. It's not just about the post-apocalypse, nuclear fire and the state of civilization being wiped clean, it is very specifically about living through what used to be California. The United States is a militant jingoistic state run by its military that pumps more and more of its economy to stay the top dog of the world, fighting over scarce resources as its citizens are comforted by the glitter of wealth that less and less citizens can afford. And that's still true in the Fallout universe, except the extra years also saw the nation commit war crimes in Canada, experiment with pathogens on people, and, along with China, destroy the world by nuclear fire in the span of 2 short hours. Stylistic trappings like the retrofuturistic technology and the cultural landscape being stuck in the 60s are, quite honestly, pointless details. They are there to underline the issues, the dissonance between the image that America projected and the state it brought onto itself. And it's all still there under all that rubble. The aesthetics from the Cold War, when fear of nuclear holocaust lived hand in hand with smiling housewives selling you soap, was just a perfect fit. Like this peppy corporate mascot showing you all the neat ways to handle yourself outside the vault after you come out to reclaim the Earth after the scourge that was, at this point, a foregone conclusion. I'm sure there's no way somebody would miss the point of this obvious satire. Ah, shit. Some call the first Fallout game bleak. I wholeheartedly disagree. Sure, the idea of living your entire life surrounded by ruins of a dream that collapsed onto itself despite telling everyone around how it would revolutionize the world might seem harsh. But you know what? That's where I grew up, and I'm not going to start calling my childhood sad, bleak, depressing or whatever. Less radiation and bunnies on the roads, sure, but surrounded by a broken dream nonetheless. Within the 27 years I spent in this country, I saw it build back up, grow economically, get roads that are not 80% potholes, make cultural products recognized all over the world. And now I feel like it's spiraling into ruin all over again as our government looks for enemies to pin blame on for various problems, both internally and externally, while the biggest opposing party is too busy reaming those in power to adequately address any of the issues the common people might have. Curious, ain't it? Not facing the music and tearing down instead of building up is the prime sin in Fallout as well. The first openly antagonistic organization you meet are the Great Khans. As the name indicates, they look backwards for their identity, trying to be a raiding force to be reckoned with like the Khanats of old. Even if you don't personally exterminate them, the future holds nothing but pain and disappointment for them, as future installments in the West Coast trilogy show. And then there's the big battle of the entire game, the Master, seeking to unite mankind by forcibly turning us into hulking, powerful mutants, trying to destroy the divides that appear between humans to try and reach an impossible goal using the tools that only brought misery before the bombs fell. Ironically, you can point out that his plan has no future at all. The super mutants of his creation are sterile. The path of forced unification, once again, only leads to the brink of total annihilation. And if that wasn't enough goddamn irony, the game ends with the protagonist kicked out of their home. The Vault, eternally locked in the past, cannot accept a vector of change. There is no place inside a time capsule for someone that shaped the future of this small piece of the world. The Vault Dweller has to, once again, walk out into the wastes and face the world they helped create and preserve, for better or worse. Though honestly, unless you are dragging your feet, the future of California looks pretty hopeful. It becomes a brand new state of its own. The theme of facing the future for better or worse and the myopia of looking into the past for solutions is present in all three Fallout games, you know, the ones that matter. But rather than talk about them, I want to look at another title released 22 years later, marketed with the lines, from the creators of original Fallout and by the developers of Fallout New Vegas. The Outer Worlds. I saw some people disappointed in that game, and I get that. Looking at the trailer, it's easy to see why people expected a follow-up to New Vegas, a long game full of intricate characters, complex factions, and interesting choices. After all, it's by Obsidian, and the gameplay looks just the same. And it got announced at the heels of Fallout 76, which continues to be a burning dumpster. So it's clearly the devs trying to show Bethesda how it's done, right? No. First of all, let's address what creators of original Fallout means. That moniker held the return of Tim Kane and Leonard Boyarsky, the lead developer and artist of the first Fallout game, respectively. That universe was, in large part, their child. But, fun fact, they didn't even stick around for Fallout 2. The sequel was rushed by Interplay after the sudden success of the original and, irritated by suits and piling demands, the two leads left the project and made Troika Games, producing games such as Arcanum or Vampire Bloodlines, both absolute bangers by the way. They had zero role in the development of New Vegas. If you want more info on how the development of Fallout 2 went, watch Greenbeard's new video and support the Gov Gamer Nation. Just like a teenage me was disappointed by Fallout 1 not being more of Fallout 2, a lot of people seemed disappointed by Outer Worlds, not aware that the different creative leads between titles led to very different goals when making each game and, in turn, very different results. Just like the original Fallout, Outer Worlds is a streamlined experience focused on a single thematic point, which goes as follows. Hey! Remember our previous game, where people tried to survive on a nuclear wasteland? Boy, they sure had it easy, huh? You know, for all the death and misery that nuclear fire causes, there is one undeniable advantage to it. It destroys everything. The people, the buildings, the social structures, political conflicts and power dynamics that brought about the end to begin with. It burns everything away and blows away the debris that obstructed the view of the future. The people in the Halcyon colony don't have that luck. They are tied by several decades of red tape BDSM. The late stage robber capitalism just refuses to collapse onto itself, no matter how many bricks they put on the acceleration pedal, resulting in a scenario far worse than extinction by warfare. Stagnation. Social mobility is non-existent, as the ruling class imposes more and more ways of keeping the rubble out, like rent for graves or company-mandated career paths. Deterministic fatalism is the primary religion in the system, and even as entire settlements rot away and crumble, the boot on everyone's neck just keeps pressing down harder and harder, not lightening up. Your companions are initially either completely resigned to just surviving within the status quo, or have no idea how to even start changing it. Bless your big, stupid heart, Felix. But you won't be the Lenin of this star system by beating people up with sports equipment. The kind of exceptionalism criticized by Outer Worlds is not one rooted in nationalism, but that of classicism. Or, in other words, if Fallout was a criticism of America specifically, Outer Worlds is a judgmental view on the economic and cultural system of capitalism, even as it's divorced from the confines of Earth. It's a ball of spit directed towards the entitlement of the entrenched powers, as people who never did a single productive thing in their lives dwell in luxury. It's a cry against learned helplessness, as those who are bled dry sheepishly accept their lot in life because that's just how things are. That's what science and scriptures both say. The notion that, oh, that's just how life is so encoded into people that the only reason it seems horrifying to us is because we occupy a world that is better by a few margins. And so did the player character, being a human popsicle that got unfrozen 7 decades too late. The twist that the system is heading towards extinction comes as no surprise to anyone but the characters that spend their entire lives believing that this is just how life has to be. But it's not the quick, merciful flash of an atom bomb that threatens Halcyon. It's starvation. Slow, excruciating death of a species as they are unfit to the environment and the nutrition it provides them. And as expected, the powerful aim for a solution that only saves them, freezing everyone they control indefinitely as they look for a solution, effectively gaining ultimate power over everyone from the underclass, controlling not only how they work and what rights they have, but even when they live, towing those they need as a labor force at any particular moment. Absolute stagnation, even as life goes on. We might have been spinning tales of the end times and apocalypse since the dawn of thought, but remember, hell is said to be eternal. There is no end to the torment, there is no waking up from the nightmare, there is no change that can save you from the infinity of it. Finality of it all seems like a petty fear in comparison. Luckily, there is an alternative, unfreezing the other colonists from your ship, aptly named Hope. The game keeps repeating how it's because it houses some of the brightest minds that were ever sent into space, but honestly, it feels like these people are a solution because they were not poisoned by the status quo of Halcyon. That they, just like you, are able to see how insane the situation is and would be willing to act to stop it. Outer Worlds did not wow me. It might seem like I'm treating it as some grand, eye-opening experience, but it did not say anything that was not deep within my rotten, cynical heart for years now. But I cannot discredit the notion that it can be that for someone else. People are born every day, and maybe this will be the work that jolts someone awake as they see the similarities between the bitter parody and their life. Maybe there will be less degrees of separation between their existence, and Parvati saying how her work conditions were pretty good because she was guaranteed 8 hours of sleep a day, even if it wasn't always consecutive. I do think that Outer Worlds is extremely valuable as a piece of interactive art, just like Fallout is. Both convey important messages through a lens of dark humor and dire, seemingly hopeless situations. But in both games, there is hope, and always in the form of the main character. It might be easy to overlook player agency as a factor of how a story is told, because of how no video game can exist without it. But I think it's important to take note of it. After all, both in Fallout and in Outer Worlds, you can be the one to squander that hope as well. Both games give you the choice to tap out and side with the villain. Going against them is a conscious choice. You need to pick the dialogue option that tells them to shove their myopic ideals where the sun doesn't shine. Or shove it there yourself with a gun. Here's to 2021, eh? Hey, that's it for the video. It's not the topic I had in mind, but playing Outer Worlds gave me ideas, and here we are. I'll try to remake the Disco Elysium and Pathologic videos next. The scripts are already done, it's just their quality that I'm ashamed of. If you want to support me, I opened up Patreon. If you'd rather just make a one-time donation, I have a Ko-fi as well. Any amount of support goes a long way in keeping me alive, and the video's coming. Enjoy your December. Have a good one.